everyone, and welcome to Finding Your Place in the Future of Food. My name is Mike Von Massow. I'm a faculty member in the Department of Food, Agricultural, and Resource Economics at the University of Guelph. And I'm going to do two things today. I'm going to talk a little bit about what kinds of how jobs in agriculture are changing. And I'm going to talk a little bit about then how what kind of jobs are available because of that. And also talk then about some significant trends that I think are interesting in the food system, in the whole food system, and how that might affect some of the jobs that you'll see going forward. I will have some time at the end for questions. If you have questions, you can see the Q&A function here in the Zoom, and feel free to drop questions in there, and I will address any that I am able to, given both my knowledge and the time constraints. So without further ado, I am going to share a few slides with you as we go forward. And I'm assuming there that you can see my my slides, and we will proceed from here. As I said, my name is Mike Von Massow, and I study how people think about food, how people make food choices, and what that means for the production system all the way from farm to fork. If you are considering, or a student at the University of Guelph or a graduate at the University of Guelph, if you're taking anything to do with food and agricultural business, you'll likely see me at some point. So I spent some time as I was getting ready for this presentation thinking about how do people think about farmers? And I'm going to start at the farm, but I'm not going to stay at the farm. But how do people think about farmers? And I think overwhelmingly, if I did a Google search, which I did here, and just clicked images and said farmer images, and overwhelmingly you get sort of a bunch of sort of middle-aged white guys. If you are my 89-year-old father, who now lives in a retirement home, but hasn't lived on a farm since the 1940s, but still has a vision of what a farm is and what a farm looks like. This one here at the bottom right would be your vision. But I think for many people, farmers are sort of these people leaning on a shovel or whistlers, you know, the standing there with a pitchfork. And the truth is considerably different. Technology and opportunity are really driving significant change in agriculture. And to me, what's interesting is while there are lots of people who are coming to study, and it is, you know, it is a tech. I don't pretend personally that I could farm, and I have immense respect for people to farm, and it is only becoming more complex. You know, this sort of futuristic view of drones going over fields, measuring everything from the temperature to the color of the leaves to highlight what kind of fertilizer we might need and calibrate specifically what kind of fertilizer we might need, to harvesting with, you know, all sorts of technology that's telling you exactly what you're getting, where you're going. We're mapping fields to target both nutrients and weed control at specific sectors of the field to really optimize production. So what this means is we don't just have farmers who have far more technical responsibility. We have supporting industries that have far more technical roles than many people would expect when we're going out into fields or into barns to produce food. And it's changing fundamentally, not just the role of the farmer, but the role of people who support agriculture as well. You know, a lot of my students a lot of them are going back to farm, but a lot of them are also going into supporting industries, which are are very technical. And as farms grow, farmers are much more likely to bring in specific consultants with specific skills. So there are opportunities to bring very specific technical and industry knowledge to bear. This picture here in the middle at the bottom is a robotic milker, which means that on some farms, farmers aren't actually milking cows anymore. These cows can go into that. You can set on the computer how many times a day they can go in. Some cows really like going in, so most people will set a max. That will free the farmer up to do a variety of other roles. I apologize. I'm just going to try and get this to be quiet. The farmer to do a bunch of other roles, and they'll have a smartphone that will tell them if something's gone wrong with either the machine or with an individual cow. And when you talk to farmers, it's fundamentally changed what they do as farmers. It's created more time for them to focus on specific management things that they need to do. And this is a robotic feeder that also makes sure that the feed is available to cows. So technology is not only making us better at things, but it's also freeing up time and allowing farmers to do, and they're supporting and the people who support them to do different things. So in the future, you know, adoption of technology for efficiency, we hear lots about labor shortages for labor savings, data-driven decisions. So we're not just doing these things on our gut feel, we're doing things with an immense pile of data, which creates its own challenges, is how do we interpret, what do we do, what do we implement? And frankly, also adaptation to climate change is technology in terms of what we're growing, what we're producing, and how we're producing it, as we adapt to changing conditions, make this a much more technically challenged, a technically challenging job. Again, not just for the people who are doing the work on a day-to-day basis or controlling the robotic milker or controlling the autonomous tractor, but the people who are supporting them as well, who are developing that technology, who are developing the new plant hybrids, who have a good understanding of weed control and can go in and help farmers make optimal decisions. And the other thing I think that's critically important going forward is this sort of need for a detailed strategy. I look at, and I'm going to, at several points during this presentation, I'm going to sound like a grumpy old guy, and that's okay, because I am a bit of a grumpy old guy. And so what I think is worth highlighting here is that things are different than they used to be. I used to hear farmers talk about themselves as producers all the time. We're a cattle producer, or we're a grain producer, or we're this. And really what's changing is they are becoming managers now, and they are allocating their resources in a way that provides the best opportunity for success for their operation. And it means that not everyone is producing things the same way. We're getting much more variety, and that is making it critically important for farmers to be good managers, to have a plan, and to modify that plan as they go forward. Not only what to produce, but how to produce it, because there are more and more choices there. And it's not just about the farm anymore. It's about people who understand the entire food system and can bring that to bear regardless of where their role is in the food system. Quick service restaurants, fast food, are playing an immense role in driving production decisions in this country, and in fact, around the world. The fact that companies like Tim Hortons and McDonald's and A&W and others have made commitments on how the eggs they serve in breakfast sandwiches will be produced, or how the beef they serve in burgers will be produced. They are driving production decisions at the farm, and A&W has people who understand agricultural production who work for them and help them make decisions. And so we need people throughout the value chain. It doesn't mean if you go to study agriculture and food, or if you go to take a job in agriculture and food, that you're going to end up in a rural setting supporting farmers. You could end up in downtown Vancouver at the A&W office driving decisions on what to deliver to consumers, which then drive decisions all the way back. I would argue that restaurants, and I'll talk about this a little bit in more detail later, that restaurants are profoundly important in shaping our perceptions of food, because they make choices for us. Now, we have this illusion that we make choices when we go to the restaurant, because there's a menu and we can choose which product we want. But if you think about it, you can't go to the drive-thru and say, I'd like the cage-free egg McMuffin, please. They are making a choice as to how those eggs are produced, because they don't have the opportunity, like the grocery store has, to have 15 different SKUs of eggs. They have one type of egg, they make that choice, and then they tell you why they made that choice, and that shapes our decisions more broadly. Online, through COVID, has grown substantially. If you've walked through a grocery store, you often see those shoppers who are picking grocery orders. We saw a real rise through early in COVID. It has dropped back a little bit as people saw, well, I can get out to a grocery store again and it gets me out of the house. So we saw it bounce back, but I think this will only continue to grow. It's in fact a bit of a tension in our house. I'd love to order everything online and have it delivered to my house, but my wife still likes to see what she's going to buy, so we do kind of a blended approach. This one here in the upper right is the warehouse that Sobeys Voila program. They don't pick orders for online groceries from a store. If you look at the average person picking from a store, will pick a 50 item order in something like 45 to 60 minutes. This warehouse, which is full of robotics and some people, will pick a 50 item order in 2 to 4 minutes. And so it's changing the economics. So people are designing robots, people are deciding how to lay out this thing, they're deciding which products to put in there, how to sell them. Again, people with an understanding of the food system, but that is, to me, a long way from the farm. The other point, and I'm going to get to this again in a minute, is this sort of proliferation of choice. The bottom right here is a milk counter, and there are a number of different varieties of milk, plus there are the plant-based beverages that are also becoming important choices for everyone. So understanding there's product development. There was a session earlier today, food scientists. So you have food scientists who do product development. You have merchandisers who decide what to offer. You have retail managers who decide how to present it, and you have processors deciding what to bring to market. So there are roles throughout food that are interesting, that are challenging, that require a high level of skill and training. And frankly, everywhere in between. We're hearing lots of news nowadays about supply chain and logistics. If you're really looking to make money off the start, there's evidence that people who start in supply chain roles earn on average 25% more than the rest of their cohort when they leave university. It's because those are important roles, they're technical roles, and they've historically been difficult to fill. So there are roles in figuring out how to get things from the farm to the consumer effectively and efficiently, and that's important. Processing is important, We have a variety of roles in processing, and we're seeing technology. We last year with COVID, we saw as outbreaks happened at some of these large meat processing facilities that they had to shut down. We will see an increase in automation. The bottom right is a picture of an automatic patty maker, where the patties are shaped, frozen, and shipped without ever being touched by a human hand. You'll have people watching it, but not necessarily doing anything. We'll see the development of technology further back in that facility, but because of biology and inconsistent sizing, it becomes a little bit more difficult at the primary processing, but we're gonna see that increase. So again, we're gonna see roles in merchandising, we're gonna see roles in food safety, this upper left, we're gonna see roles in engineering, we're going to see roles in logistics. There are such, and those roles are becoming increasingly more complex because the entire food system is becoming more complex. So to me, there's no place more interesting to be right now than in the food sector. The jobs are changing. I think I talked about this a little bit already. The need for a high level understanding of the food system. If you work for a grocery store, lots of grocery stores are hiring our students because they understand the entire food system. And I think that that becomes a differential advantage for students. A greater understanding of technology and data, the ability to understand, analyze, and present data becomes profoundly important. And as a manager, regardless of where you are, it is figuring out which data matters and what it's telling us. And just again, highlight the fact that food work may never involve seeing a farm. We have animal science graduates who are working as animal welfare auditors for Tim Hortons. We see plant science graduates who are working for food processors to optimize selection of product to give maximum freshness as they bring things to market, or to sort things so that we maximize the freshness and minimize the waste we're throwing out. So there are, again, in the time I have available, I don't have the time to talk in detail about the range of jobs. But what I would say is, look, you'll find something that's of interest to you as an individual. So that's kind of my overview. Let's talk a little bit about what's changing in the food system, if you will, is what is, what are some of the trends, issues, or challenges that are coming up in the food system that will shape and influence the jobs throughout the food system. And I'm going to start at the consumer end, because someone told me once that the interesting thing is, we call it a value chain or a supply chain for a reason, because you can't push a chain. Consumers are at the end of the chain and they can change where they are, and the chain has to respond. If you're at the other end of the chain and you try and push it, nothing moves and you don't make a whole lot of progress. So let's start at the consumer end of this. And the first thing I'll say is, consumers, we hear often about the need to develop trust in the food system, but the evidence is pretty clear, I would argue, that consumers generally feel pretty good about the Canadian food system. They feel good about farmers. I would argue the issue isn't trust. The real challenge is a lack of understanding of how food is produced. And to me, this really creates an imperative for action for anyone who's working in the food chain. It means that we need to be ready for questions. I would argue it means that we need to be proactive no matter where we are in the food chain, towards helping people understand. What do I mean there? Let's get to a couple of slides and then I'll expand on it here. Consumers really have very little understanding of production. And if you don't know the answers to these questions, don't feel bad. You're not unique. I even do these sometimes in front of farm groups and have people who are puzzled. So chickens raised for meat are slaughtered at the age of 4. That is false. So you should say disagree. Less than 40% of Canadians got that correct. A little bit over half say, I don't know, where they're being honest. And a little less than 10% say, yeah, that seems right. I would argue that of these 40%, at least another 10% guessed and didn't know. So what that says is if we're trying to have a detailed and nuanced understanding with a consumer or a member of the public about raising chickens when they don't know those basics, we need to think about that. A dairy cow gives milk only after calving. That is true. That is basic mammalian biology, that cows don't produce milk unless they have a calf. About a third of people got that right. About 40% of people said, I don't know, and were honest. And almost a third got it wrong. So again, we have these, you know, people who really don't understand how food is produced, who are susceptible to confusion. And it's really sort of critical for us to engage. I'm highlighting this because I think that regardless of what it highlights is the importance of having that sort of comprehensive understanding of the food system to really add value in any discussion, regardless of the role that you're playing. So let's look at what people think are important. This is in 2015. We asked people what do they think about the current state of farm animal welfare in Canada. Very general, generic question. You know, a third, here's another 12. So roughly 40% said, yeah, it's pretty good. About a third said, I have no idea. They're being honest. And here about a quarter said, we don't think it's very good. Now, when we ask people 4 years later, people feel much better about animal welfare. I would argue that this is largely because people are hearing about animal welfare, particularly from big restaurant companies making commitments, but we saw the Retail Council of Canada make commitments as well. So as people feel good about the industry, they get a little bit worried when they hear things, hidden videos or other things. But when the companies reassure them and say, here's what we're doing, here's why we're doing them, people generally start to feel a little better about it. You can see this graph on antibiotic use is very similar to the 2015 graph on the 2015 graph on animal welfare. I would argue that this is one that is coming and we'll see a lot more discussion. So consumers don't have a really good understanding of what's happening, but they do respond to specific words. They like things that sound good. Nest boxes. Now I could ask, you know, I can ask a consumer, how do you feel about nest boxes for laying hens? And they'll say, oh man, that sounds great. I really think they should have them. What are they? I have no idea. And so again, it highlights how what we communicate, we can't use weasel words, but what we communicate becomes very important. And they don't like things that sound bad. Cages, regardless of what else is in that housing facility, if they hear the word cage, it's bad. And I would argue that parts of agriculture have done a bad job of going from battery cages to enriched cages as an example. And in that circumstance, consumers still just hear the word cage. What's interesting is the word antibiotics is seen as bad by many consumers. And to me, that becomes a welfare issue, that antibiotics used responsibly, used in the right way, help sick animals get better, and that there are negative welfare implications for animals that are left sick. And so we need to think about how we communicate in that context. And we're also susceptible to surprises, hidden camera events, whether they're common, whether the issues in the hidden camera are common or rare, it doesn't matter. These are a small sample, but they shape consumer perceptions. So 10 years ago or so, there was a W5 episode on a farm in Alberta that showed layer hens that wasn't very representative, but that became the truth for many consumers. There subsequently, there was a video on a dairy farm in the Fraser Valley. Again, that one was not a typical farm, but it became the reality for many people. So if you don't have a good understanding, you're really susceptible to minimal exposure, and that really shaping your perception of what happens. Again, going back to the real value of understanding the broad perception of agriculture. I don't know if you've heard the words Buttergate over the past winter. There were people who suggested that butter was getting harder. There was no evidence that butter was getting harder, but there was this sort of, oh God, we've got to change production practices. We don't, you know, butter was in short supply. Butter demand went up significantly in the pandemic because people were baking, people were at home. I became one of those insufferable bread breakers during the pandemic. So my butter demand went up. And so there were some people who said the way we were producing butter was causing part of the problem. And so again, we weren't looking at it systematically. So we need people who have a good understanding of the broad system who can bring answers to bear in these issues. And marketing. I am astounded, frankly, that we're seeing a quick service burger restaurant have TV commercials now where they are showing grass and roots on a TV commercial to sell burgers. And we're shaping people's perceptions of the products and what we say and how we say it from them. And how we say it to them matters, and we need to make sure we do it credibly. This one is one someone sent me and asked me a question. What does this mean? Comfort farm. Eggs coming from hens raised in furnished housing, including perches and nesting areas. Now, if you read that, that's entirely accurate. And perches and nesting, I talked about nest boxes, are positive in terms of welfare, but you might read that and think, oh, well, these are birds that are, you know, free and easy and free run and have outside access. No, all it's saying is they have perches and nesting areas. They are probably still in, and for good reason, frankly, in smaller groups, but they have access to different housing and to mechanisms that allow them to display natural behaviors. Hens like a little bit of privacy when they lay an egg. And so a nesting area is really just a curtain with a little bit of bedding that allows them to have some privacy while they lay an egg. So again, we're telling people stuff, but we're maybe not telling them everything. So let's get to a couple of other trends that I think are important that are both making the food system an interesting place to work, but also requiring a different set of skills. We're seeing what I call consumer dispersion. When I was a university student many years ago, let me just take a sip of my tea here. We were always taught the consumer, the consumer, the consumer. The truth is there is no the consumer. People are different. And we're seeing this sort of wider dispersion of the types of choices. Another grumpy old guy moment. when I was a kid, there weren't as many choices in the grocery store as there is today. And that's not because you or I want more choice. It's because you and I, as individuals, want different things. And so strategically, what grocery stores have to do differently is think about how best to present those options in a way that allows you to make the choices you want, but allows them also to still take advantage of some impulse buys. So we're seeing an evolution, a strategic evolution in many grocery stores from product-focused aisles to consumer-focused aisles. Historically, grocery stores were laid out so that they wanted you to walk down every aisle and fill your cart. And one of the most important metrics that grocery stores have is what's called size of basket, is how it's a low margin business, how much they can get you to put in their in your cart. But if they have so much choice that it's overwhelming consumers, sometimes they'll switch stores or they won't go down specific aisles. And so we're seeing then, you know, if you go to some big grocery stores, you're now seeing the health food section, where you'll have a smaller subset of, in this example, cereal. Or you'll have an international aisle where you will have more sort of ethnic focused foods. And so you'll look for stuff that's of interest to you rather than look at all the products that might fit into that category. And so again, this accelerates as consumers learn more about agriculture. And just, this is one of my research associates. These glasses that he's wearing are eye tracking glasses that we use for research, which allow us to see what a research participant looks at. So we can look at what they evaluate and we can provide insight to processors and to grocers as to what works with individual consumers. There's also a wide dispersion in how we produce, how we sell, what products they have, and new products. And I'm going to go through this relatively quickly in the interest of time. It means there's going to be more difference between producers. That gets back to the managers versus producers on the farm. We've seen a real resistance to do that in the past. We wanted to all be the same. There's changes in the value chain structure. This goes beyond, online groceries versus in-person groceries. It means that we're changing the relationships with farmers growing specific products for specific customers. It's not all going through the same funnel and then out again. We're developing direct relationships between producers, processors, and grocery stores so that you know exactly where that stuff is coming from. And from a farmer perspective, that's a strategic advantage because it makes it more difficult for that buyer to switch away from me if they can save a couple of pennies. And that's what I mean by an anchored value chain. As an example, we now have the technology to synthesize casein and whey from yeast. Casein and whey are important dairy proteins. And so we can produce some elements of dairy products without actually having a cow there. And so this is coming. Those products are on the market. We've heard about lab-grown meat. In Singapore today, you can get lab-grown chicken nuggets in a restaurant. They're still $25 or $30 for an order, so they're not cheap by any means yet. But it means that these products are coming and that they will change, that we will have food products that will never have seen a field. And again, that technology is driving both choice. Is that the end of livestock production? No. But it does mean there'll be some disruption. It means that we'll have to think about how we produce livestock, what attributes we produce in livestock, and how we compete with some of these other products. How am I doing? I'm doing well for time. The rise of alternate proteins, not just lab-grown proteins, but also plant-based, are playing a bigger role. Almost 50% of Canadians say they are increasing plant-based protein. I would argue that it's that group that is much more important to understand than the 5 to 7% that are vegetarian and vegan. These people are really driving because they want different things. They want different attributes, and they are a bigger group of consumers that we need to keep happy. Many of those people still like red meat, but what red meat are they eating? How often are they eating it? What size of cut are they eating? All of those things are going to have strategic implications for the food system going forward. Gene editing is another issue that's coming up. CRISPR, the editing technology, means that it's very easy to do these things. It's different from genetic engineering, where we're putting a gene from one species into another. It really is just turning a gene on or turning a gene off. How will consumers respond? You know, there are things that you know, we can make products healthier. We can make add specific nutrition to it. We can improve animal welfare. Will consumers buy it? We're working to understand. That's a big focus of my current research. The rise of restaurants, I talked about a little bit already. I'm getting close to the end. So if you want to start thinking about dropping some questions into the Q&A box, if you have some, please feel free. The rise of restaurants. Before COVID, we spent almost 40% of our food dollar in restaurants. They communicate directly. They make choices for us. They shape our perceptions beyond the restaurant. And this is only going to continue to grow. Clearly, as restaurants were closed, that number went down below 40%, but it's going to come back and grow. And in fact, pre-COVID, that number was higher than 50% in the US, which gives us a sense of where that's going. Labeling. We're seeing governments want, and I'm only going to talk about here health labels, but we've looked at GMO labels, we've looked at animal welfare labels, we've looked at a variety of different things. In this case, we did a study that looked at healthy labels. Health Canada wants to put warning labels on products that are high in sugar, fat, or salt. They're saying that the nutrition information label on the side isn't good enough. They want to put a warning label at the front. And they're saying, how do we best do this? And what we looked at is warning labels do decrease demand for labeled items, but not for all labeled items and not as much as you might think. And in fact, it works best for people who are looking for it anyway. So they're not necessarily making it easier for people. They're making it easier for people who are looking for that information. They're not saying, oh, these people are eating unhealthy. Then we need to warn them. It doesn't necessarily work. So understanding how to label, what to label, and how to make it most effective becomes critically important. So the food system is evolving. There will be a need for a wide variety of talented individuals to drive the industry to continued success. There are good jobs available here. Those jobs will continue to be interesting, challenging, and they are stable because we will always need to eat. So I'd encourage anyone who's looking to consider the food industry anywhere from farm to fork. I've had a long and successful career in it, and I'm happy I made the choice that I did. Just as a highlight, I didn't come from a farm and studied agricultural economics, and I'm amazed at how many people who aren't from farms are making this choice because of their interest in and excitement about the food system. So I just say that that's an opportunity. Some shameless self-promotion to finish off here. If you have questions that I didn't get to at the end, please feel free to email me. That's my email address. If you're on Twitter, that's my Twitter handle. And foodfocusguelph.ca is my blog and podcast, where I talk about issues relative to the food system. My most recent podcast, we talked about GMO labeling. So I think If you're interested, again, shameless self-promotion, feel free to go take a look. That's what I wanted to cover. I'm on about the timeline that I thought I would be. I'm now happy to answer questions, and I've got a couple in the Q&A now. So I'll read out the question. And again, if you have more, please feel free to drop them in. I will go until we either run out of time today, or we run out of questions. And so the first question is, after I have a sip of my tea. Excuse me. Can you explain the meaning of tag made in Canada or made in the US? Excuse me, I apologize. So there are a variety of labels that get put on. And so it is important to understand that. So made in Canada doesn't necessarily mean those ingredients are Canadian. It just means that it is processed in Canada. Product of Canada means that it is a Canadian product and produced in Canada. And so being clear as you read different labels becomes critically important. And if you want to know the difference, you can go to the Canadian Food Inspection Agency, who sets the rules for this. And they have different rules for different wording, which is unfortunately profoundly confusing. So it's often difficult. So, you know, as an example, I'm a big fan of honey. And if you buy honey in the grocery store, it can say Canada number one or grade A honey. If it says Canada number one, that is a grade, that is a quality standard that doesn't tell you anything about where it's from. And if you flip it around the back, you might find that it's 50% Canadian honey and perhaps 50% Argentinian honey. And so paying attention matters. And unfortunately, Zakir, it is often somewhat confusing. The other point I'll make is there are often Canadian products that don't have a made in Canada label for a variety of strategic reasons. And it might be that this company is producing products in Canada, but selling across the world and doesn't want to manage two different streams of inventory. So don't put product of Canada on it because it doesn't sell, it doesn't give it an advantage in other markets. In some markets, it may provide an advantage, but maybe not necessarily. The other point I will make there is that I've talked to a company that was making salsa in Canada using Canadian tomatoes, but they didn't have Canadian tomatoes all year round. Obviously, we have winter. And in that circumstance, they didn't put a product of Canada label on it because part of the year they weren't using Canadian tomatoes. So that's a complex question. The next question is, how can organic and free range be made more affordable? The first thing I would say is, we shouldn't always make Anna, our choice is based on cost. Now, I understand that I'm speaking from a position of privilege here, and it's easy for me to say I can afford different things. That if things are important to us as consumers, we should be willing to pay for those characteristics. We can't expect enhanced quality or a specific production practice that's important to us to be critical, to be available and not necessarily cost us more. So the first thing is there might be circumstances in which it will never be made at the exact same cost. Some of the things that we can do are, we're continuing to do research on different housing practices, free range, different production practices, organic. And I think the gap in some crops or some products is closing. So research makes a difference, and that research is happening. Volume makes a difference, and that as we demand it more, it becomes more available. It's not just the production costs that matter. It is the logistics costs, the processing costs, and as volumes go up. So it's a bit of a, pardon the pun, and a chicken and egg scenario that we have, excuse me, we have the issue of what is the quote from Field of Dreams? If you build it, they will come. We have to almost come and they will build it. And sort of as we demand more of it, prices of it will come down. I hope that answers your question. Anna, your other question was, is the food quality between organic and non-organic the same? Is there a benefit to buying exclusively organic? So Anna, I'm not an expert here, but I'll tell you what I do know. What I know is that nutritionally, there isn't a difference in between organic and conventionally produced produce. So that if you're looking at vitamin C levels, now there is some variation between different producers, but there is not an automatic advantage nutritionally between this product and that product. Where you might see a difference, and again, there are standards, are some people will argue residues. I think that that's sometimes true, but generally a stretch. Where you again have a difference is some people will argue, and again, this is always a very fraught discussion. Some people will argue that organic production is improved animal welfare, which is likely true. Less synthetic fertilizer, which is true, which may or may not have less environmental impact in terms of fertilizer runoff and things like that. So there are some things that are different between these products, and it's not universal. It's worth looking into individual products, but nutritionally, it's been pretty well established that there isn't a difference between organic products and non-organic products. Now, if you look, there's some people will argue that I buy some organic products in my house, and others I don't. I don't have a solid justification for those. There are some of my colleagues who will tell me that this type of organic is probably better than conventional, but this one in terms of food safety or other things, but this one, it's less of an issue. And so I also prioritize Canadian. So if I have a choice, I'll buy Canadian. So again, there's not a definitive answer to your question. Jake asked a question, will food safety continue to be a sector where job opportunities evolve? Food safety is obviously vitally important. Food safety and food quality are critically important. I'll give you, I was going to say last year, but it was probably the year before because last year was mostly COVID. I was in the head office of a president of a billion-dollar Canadian food processing company. And in his office, he had six TV screens up along the edge of one wall. And on four of those screens were real-time safety and quality testing metrics from all of his production facilities. Food safety is something that consumers expect. Food safety is something that companies and producers prioritize, and technology will make us better at it, but there will be great jobs in food safety, and those ones are by no means going to disappear. I think that is an area for people in food science or food chemistry. Lots of veterinarians end up in food safety. I've had some of my ag. I have one of my best friends from my master's program become a food safety officer and has had a great career. And he was an economist. So I think that there are lots of opportunities and that they will continue to be important. There's a question here. What does organic cold pressed coconut oil And I'm gonna beg off that question because I don't know enough about coconut oil to answer it credibly. And I apologize. I'm being told that I have time for one more question. But again, Zakir, can you name some harmful food coloring and ingredients manufactured food contains like MSG? Why CFRA are not banning them? Again, I can't name individual products. There was a session this morning. I think that the food scientists would have probably been better at those. The Canadian Food Inspection Agency looks at ingredients and says what is safe, what is effective for ensuring safety or other things. And then they say that individual consumers are responsible for deciding what they want and what they don't want. They require ingredient labels, they require nutrition labels. So that puts the onus on us to a degree to make some of those, to educate ourselves and make some of those choices. And frankly, I'll go back to someone like me, who's a researcher in thinking about how we communicate some of these things to consumers to help people make those choices effectively. So I weaseled out of your question a little bit, but I'd say, you know, take a look, see what you can find and educate yourself. If something is truly dangerous, then the CFIA will disallow it. I am told that I am to wrap up, that we are out of time. I want to thank you for coming. I'll reiterate that if you had questions that I didn't answer, or if I sparked a question, you can reach me by that email that I posted earlier. If you didn't write it down, you can check my name out at the University of Guelph and you will find it, or go to foodfocusguelph.ca and you can send us an email through the website there. Thank you very much for your time, and have a good rest of your day.